Iranian weapon caches located within Syrian military installations near the old Damascus-Beirut highway, northwest of the Syrian capital Damascus, were targeted by unidentified aircraft last night in what Syrian officials claim to be an Israeli bombardment. At approximately 1 a.m., aircraft launched multiple missiles from the direction of Lebanon's airspace towards Syrian military installations, and while Syria's aerial defense array was activated, a number of warehouses believed to be used by the Lebanese Hezbollah to store precision-guided munitions were reportedly destroyed. As a result, at least 4 foreign militiamen were reportedly killed in the bombardment, yet there were no immediate details about their respective nationalities. The IDF spokesperson's unit stopped short from confirming nor denying its responsibility in response to TV7's request for comment. Nevertheless, it is interesting to note that several hours prior to the attack, during a ceremony marking 10 years since Israel's Iron Dome aerial defense array became operational, Defense Minister Benny Gantz sought to remind the enemies of the Jewish state the IDF's readiness to strike at any moment in time.
בשם מדינת ישראל אני רוצה להגיד לאויבים שלנו שאנחנו עוסקים פה היום בציון עשור להגנה פעילה של מערכת כיפת ברזל. אבל זאת איננה המערכת היחידה שאנחנו מחזיקים. יש לנו מערכות התקפיות שפועלות 24/7, 365 יום בשנה, מוכנים לפעולה מול כל זירה, מול כל טווח, ובכל מימד פעולה שצהל יידרש לו.
The remarks made by Jerusalem's top defense official came ahead of Israel's annual Holocaust Day of Remembrance, or Yom HaShoah in Hebrew. Speaking at the official opening state ceremony, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu seized the opportunity to declare Israel's right as the nation-state of the Jewish people to protect itself against its enemies.
בזמן השואה לא היו לנו לא הכוח להגן על עצמנו וגם לא הזכות הריבונית להגן על עצמנו. היינו חסרי זכויות, חסרי מדינה, חסרי מגן. היום יש לנו מדינה, יש לנו כוח מגן, ויש לנו הזכות הטבעית והמלאה, כמדינתו הריבונית של העם היהודי, להגן על עצמנו מפני אויבינו.
Netanyahu went on to allude to the fact that the success of the modern state of Israel, with God's help, is essentially the fulfillment of biblical prophecy, yet underscored that the continued existence of the Jewish state is not automatically guaranteed.
קמנו לתחייה, לקחנו את גורלנו בידינו, הפכנו את מדינתנו לכוח עולמי ובכמה וכמה תחומים למעצמה עולמית. כל זה אינו מובן מאליו. קיומנו לא מובטח אוטומטית. רק אם נצרף לכוח היצירה שמפעם בנו, את כוח ההתנגדות למבקשי נפשנו, רק אז, בעזרת השם, נבטיח לדורות את מפעל התקומה והתשועה. כדבר הנביא ישעיהו, תחת היותך עזובה ושנויה ואין עובר, ושמתיך לגאון עולם מסוס מדור ודור.
Amid the continuation of indirect talks between the Biden administration and the Ayatollah regime on possibly reviving the 2015 nuclear deal, Netanyahu signaled to both Washington and Tehran that Jerusalem will not be bound by any agreement that threatens its existence.
הסכם הגרעין עם איראן, שאפשר לה בהכשר בינלאומי להתקדם לפיתוח ארסנל של פצצות אטום, הסכם זה שוב עולה על השולחן. אלא שההיסטוריה לימדה אותנו שהסכמים כאלה, עם משטרים קיצוניים כאלה, שווים כקליפת השום. גם לידידינו הטובים ביותר אני אומר, שלא תהיה שום טעות. הסכם עם איראן, שיסלול את דרכה לנשק גרעיני, נשק שמאיים עלינו בהשמדה, הסכם כזה לא יחייב אותנו כהוא זה. יש רק דבר אחד שיחייב אותנו, למנוע ממי שחותר להשמידנו לבצע את זממו.
Despite Netanyahu's assertion, the United States intends to persist with its intention to revive the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, or JCPOA, which is the technical term for the 2015 nuclear deal, since it views the multilateral agreement as the best mechanism to thwart Tehran's path to a nuclear bomb. However, it also maintains that efforts to revive the JCPOA will be very cumbersome, since, despite Iranian claims to the contrary, the United States does not intend to offer any unilateral gestures or incentives to induce Iran back to the negotiating table.
We are not and will not offer any unilateral gestures or incentives to sweeten any sort of deal or to induce Iran back to the negotiating table or to a better position at that negotiating table. The second point I will say is that this administration is committed, working in many cases with our allies and partners, to holding Iran to account for precisely the offenses you listed. Its human rights abuses, its support for terrorism, its ballistic missile program. When it comes to those areas, that is precisely why our strategy sees the mutual return to the JCPOA as necessary but insufficient. Insufficient because we seek not only a longer and stronger deal, but over the longer term, working with partners in the region, follow-on agreements to address these very issues.
Separately, the U.S. State Department announced the Biden administration's decision to resume substantive financial aid to the Palestinians, including to the United Nations Relief and Works Agency for Palestine Refugees, commonly referred to by its acronym, UNRWA.
And today, we're pleased to announce that working with Congress, we plan to restart the U.S. Economic Development, Security, and Humanitarian Assistance to the Palestinian people. It includes $75 million in economic and development assistance in the West Bank and Gaza, $10 million for peace-building programs through the U.S. Agency for International Development, or USAID, and $150 million in humanitarian assistance for the UN Relief Works Agency, or UNRWA. All assistance, of course, will be provided consistent with U.S. law.
With regard to the resumption of support for UNRWA, despite numerous allegations of corruption, non-transparency, and political advocacy against Israel, the State Department justified its decision by highlighting the fact that it attains a seat at the table, so to speak, that will enable Washington to stimulate much-needed reform.
Even when the United States had stopped its support for UNRWA, the United States, and in this case, the previous administration, did maintain a dialogue, even in the absence of funding, with UNRWA. By resuming this assistance today, not only do we have that dialogue, but we have a seat at the table. We can help drive UNRWA in the ways that we think it is in our interest and consistent with our values to do. Obviously, there are areas where we would like to see reform. We will continue to be in a position, an even greater position, to drive and to steer UNRWA in a direction that we think is productive and useful with this step today.
Israel responded to the American decision with evident frustration.
Israel is strongly opposed to the anti-Israel and anti-Semitic activity happening in UNRWA's facilities. We believe that this UN agency for so-called refugees should not exist in its current format. UNRWA schools regularly use materials that incite against Israel, and the twisted definition used by the agency to determine who is a refugee only perpetuates the conflict.